How are you guys doing today? It's Anthony Gangi. Welcome to another episode of Tier Talk. Guys, we are live. It's been a while since we went live. I thought we could start 2023 off right. I'm going to try to commit to one live episode once or twice a week. I'll bring on different people from the corrections profession and we'll discuss whatever topics you want to discuss, because when we do a live, we may have some topics. Like I said, this year is we're going to be talking about dealing with high profile inmates. Again, it relates to a topic we just had with Duty Ron, the person that murdered four individuals in Idaho. They're getting ready to be placed inside jail. Well, he's in jail now, getting ready to be placed into a prison. What's life going to be like for that person inside a prison? So we're going to talk about some high profile individuals, our interactions with them, what we do with them. And my two guests are going to share some stories because they've actually met some pretty unique high profile individuals. Russ out of Cali, and then we have Joe out of Texas. And I think it's just going to be an overall good dialogue. And then, as I said, if you guys have questions along the way, keep asking them because we're going to answer them. I mean, that's what we do. We'll try to keep on topic. But if they go to the left or the right, I'm good with that too, because we're here to answer any questions and, you know, you may have, because not a lot of people have access to people that work in a prison. So this would be a great opportunity to share some of our experiences. Now, guys, real quick, the show is sponsored to you by American Military University. If you guys are looking to get a degree, seek higher education, please check out American Military University. It's a great school, very supportive of what we do in corrections, and also very supportive of what we do here on Tier Talk. Okay, so let me get Russ. What's up, Russ?
Anthony, how are you doing, sir?
So, hey, Russ, we're getting a lot of love. We got Julia back here, Scout, greeting from Rockland County. Hello, Anthony, just subscribed. Welcome aboard. Bell, it was a pleasure. Ask the questions. We are very... You know, we're very interactive, so feel free to ask the questions now so we can go ahead. And we just lost Russ, but he'll be back, I'm sure. So I'll bring in my backup, Joe. Correctional officer always has backup. I'm sure Russ will come back. But we're here to answer whatever questions come your way about the criminal justice system. But we are going to focus a little bit today about dealing with high-profile inmates and maybe even share some stories. So, Joe, let's do it a little. Joe, do you mind introducing yourself to our audience?
Yeah, sure. Why not? I don't think I'll pop out anytime soon. My name is Joe Pomponio. Yeah, Anthony said we're going live, man. I even shaved and everything. My name's Joe. What? My name's Joe Pomponio. There's the Russ Meister. He popped back in.
Hey, did you know that Joe shaved for today's live?
I believe he did.
Oh, my God. And okay, so Joe, do you mind introducing yourself, your experience and all, please?
Absolutely. My name is Joe Pomponio. I'm a retired lieutenant from the Texas Department of Criminal Justice of 30 years.
And by the way, Joe, thank you for this was kind of very last minute. So thank you for coming on. I appreciate
Not a problem.
And then Russ, you mind introducing yourself to our audience?
My name is Russ Hamilton, and I am a former and retired sergeant from California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation, where I started way back at San Quentin in 1989. I also have experience as a senior juvenile correctional officer. I currently work for a private company where we do reentry and rehabilitation work for a local probation department and a local county jail, where I am a case manager.
All right, so guys, think about all the stuff that we could answer today, dealing with juveniles, dealing with women. I mean, just a bunch of topics. So I'm going to go right into the first question. So the topic right now is going to be dealing with high-profile inmates. That's kind of what we're going to be centered around. So the first question, I just want to get the first question out there, comes from Sakashi Productions. Is it ever justified to treat notoriously dangerous, violent criminals more harshly than other inmates? I'm going to say no. That's an easy no. Would you guys agree?
I disagree.
Yeah. Well, wait. Yeah. Oh, so it's no, right? We're on the same page. It's no. So why don't we do this real quick, just to warm it up a little bit. Hey, Russ, name some of the inmates that were high profile that you actually interacted with. Because, guys, mind you, guys, serial killers were big around the late 70s, mid 80s. So Russ actually worked next to a few of them, including the Midnight Stalker. Am I correct?
The Night Stalker, which was Richard Ramirez. Let's see, I had interactions with David Carpenter, Rodney Ayala. I had interactions with Tookie Williams. He was the founder of the Crips. Lawrence Bittaker and his partner Ray Norris. Just lots of different ones. There's probably a lot of them that I forgot. But anyway, being on death row at San Quentin, you see these characters, these individuals all the time.
Now, obviously, in my position as well, I also deal with a lot of people that are very antisocial. A few of them have Netflix specials. It is what it is. But Russ, you did have an interaction with the Night Stalker, correct?
Oh, yeah. Many, many times. You know, there was one instance I know where a guy who was my partner had asked him, you know, why did you cut out that lady's eyes? And he told him that, well, she just had really pretty eyes. These guys, you know, often they're lionized, you know, on television shows and all this kind of stuff. But when you get down to it, basically, they're just a bunch of very base people who are really the lowest of the low. I don't even consider them to be evil. Like a lot of people throw that word evil around. They're just base. They're disgusting. And, you know, people, you know, want to get all fascinated and stuff with me. I tell you, I had my fill of them over the years I was at San Quentin.
I will say tell you this right now, the letters that they get from followers. I mean, people that are either, I think, to be honest with you, they're connected to, I think the people that do write to these inmates, for some reason, I think they're just women that long for some level of attention, and they connect more to the crime of it all. Because, I mean, you got to see some of these inmates that get the letters from a lot of females or just fans of, you know, what they've done, and they want to be their pen pals. But I think in the long run, I think what they want to do is they want to brag also to their friends. Oh, look who I'm writing to. I'm writing to the Night Stalker. I'm writing to Ted Bundy. I mean, ultimately, it's crazy.
I say ultimately too, it's actually, for a lot of these women, it's actually a very safe relationship, believe it or not. Because there's no chance of them having any actual real interaction with them. And so when you have that type of a relationship, you know, you're really in control, because you can cut it off and have absolutely no repercussions from it whatsoever.
And hey, Joe, did you ever deal with any high profile inmates in your time in Texas?
Yeah, I dealt with a couple. I dealt with Resendez, the railroad car killer, and dealt with a guy by the name of Harris, Billy Joe Harris. He was deemed the Twilight rapist. And oddly enough, he was also a correctional officer.
I wish I could tell you the ones I've dealt with, because I'm still on the job. But guys, trust and believe, I've dealt with some good ones as well. I just can't mention it, but I will once I retire in 5 years. But what I thought we could do, guys, is talk about dealing with high-profile inmates. I mean, yes, we're going to kind of branch off what Duty Ron had in his discussion, which is great. Thank you, Duty Ron, for having me. Oh, Duty Ron's actually in the audience. Hey, Duty Ron, what's up? Guys, we get a chance. You know, if you're not subscribed to him, which most of my followers are, check out his channel. But guys, I think the cool part of this all is that we're going to go through the process and let you know how inmates are actually, high-profile inmates are treated inside our facilities, inside our prisons and our jails. But it does start through intake. So having said that, the one thing I will tell you about the media when it comes to high profile inmates, they kill us. Media does kill us when it comes to dealing with high profile inmates, because they will throw out stories randomly sometimes, but just constantly. And the problem is, if we have an inmate that we're watching out for, let's say, because to be honest with you, that's our job. When the inmate gets in our system, we are responsible for that inmate's well-being. It makes it tough when they start broadcasting the specific details of the crime. And then there's always the shocker too, where you finally, the inmate's, you know, been serving time, you know, finally we're getting ready to maybe get this inmate out into general population, because it's been a few years and we're good to go get this guy ready. And all of a sudden you got that 10-year anniversary where Netflix decides, hey, let's air this, or, you know, Lifetime decides, let's revisit this again. All of a sudden the inmate comes, hey, what's going on? Oh, sorry, got to come back in, because unfortunately your case is starting to trend a little bit again. But let's talk about that real quick, Russ. Does the media, and I'll go Russ first and Joe, does the media affect our handling of those notorious high profile inmates? But how, first of all, how would you define a high-profile inmate?
I would say that a high profile inmate is an individual who has gained enough notoriety either through their crime or enough fame through the person who they were before they got into trouble with the law, that there remains a generalized interest from the social media or the predominant media cultists. That is your journalists, because I don't have much use for them. I don't have much use for them. Anyway, you know, and so they are worthy in the minds of at least the journalists of, you know, airtime, you know, the people, you know, spend money on, you know, buying advertising or print time where people, you know, buy ads in magazines and newspapers still.
Yeah. And what's your thoughts on that, Joe, with the media and how it affects our handling of those high profile inmates?
I mean, yeah, I mean, publicly, we, you know, a lot of times we'll make it look like we're handling, you know, handling the situation with kid gloves. And, but, you know, if you've done a job long enough, you know, a thug is a thug is a thug. You know, we treat them the same. However, you know, you got some that are higher profile, like the guy from Richmond, the one that had his little harem there, his little Mormon community. And anyways, we had to keep him away from the telephones. The judge had to go as far as putting a gag order on him to keep him away from telephones, because he was still making transactions from the jails via telephone. So, you know, certain situations we have to handle inmates differently, especially with the high profile inmates, you know. Otherwise it's really just another day on the job.
And I will say one thing, one thing we don't like, I'm sure county jails definitely will not like it. I know we don't like it, but we're probably going to get those high profile inmates eventually, is the attention that high profile inmates bring to the facility. I mean, when you have a high profile inmate come into your facility, your practices have to be on point, because they're going to be all over that facility. They're going to want access, which you're probably not going to give them. I don't think any facility should be doing that. The media is still the media. And to be honest with you, they're not in a position to video everything freely and decide what's not a security concern to air. I mean, they had a show on air called 60 Days In. And I think the first season or the first two seasons was done wrong. They would videotape everything. And then before they would release it, they would show it to the sheriff. And it's like, no, that their people should be watching it at all times, because there was a lot of concerns that happened during the videoing of that they didn't know until it was being looked at for a final review, which, by the way, it was already filtered. So having said that, the media, when they get their hands on or when they're interested into a facility, I mean, besides the fact that it opens up the door to all these practices, they don't understand what some of those practices are. So the way they present it to the public is also a concern, because next thing you know, we start going through these changes because all of a sudden we got this inmate right now that's in our facility that's high profile. So again, you know, we're not a real big fan of the attention that a high profile inmate brings to the facility. Would you agree with that, Russ?
Yeah. And, you know, I'll say one thing that's a little bit different when we handle it from the prison side, at least in California. They all had high notoriety due to the fact that they were on death row, at least, you know, the area that I worked in for a while. And so every one of them, you know, was bolstered up there just by virtue of the fact that they could say, hey, I'm a death penalty inmate. I'm condemned to die. And so, you know, of course, we don't want to try and cater to them. But by the same token, you know, they actually have a lot of access to media. And that, you know, they write letters and everyone out there wants to interview them and things like that. And so it's a really kind of a dangerous situation, in my estimation, to, you know, just give that much carte blanche to be able to, you know, make any claim that they want to make and to be able to, you know, just run roughshod by being able to say that, you know, we're doing something wrong.
Yeah, I actually want to answer this one question, but I think Joe jumped on it real quick. But I'll get Joe to maybe go first, and all three of us. What do you guys think about the officers that are obsessed with watching true crime shows? Does it have a negative effect on their performance? So I have an idea, but I'll have you go first, Joe. You said your wife watches it?
Yeah, I mean, hell, my wife's a CO, and she watches 48 Hours and what's the man hater channel, Lifetime Network, and, you know, she watches all those crime shows. And, hell, I'm still walking around breathing. for now.
Better watch out.
For now. But, you know, does it affect your performance? No, it's just another TV show you watch. I mean, it's like having a sheriff's deputy or a police officer. They go home and they watch, you know, Cops or you know, PD Live on the Reels channel or, you know, it doesn't, you can watch them all day long. You know, it shouldn't affect your job performance any. You know, it's just a TV show.
Yeah, guys, I'll tell you something. That's the one thing about working in corrections and being professional. I mean, everybody, you know, that's in that prison, you know, have done something or in the jail has done something, and you have to always remain objective and you're dealing with them, because if at any moment they could point to some level of biased treatment based on the crime that they've committed, you could find yourself without a job very quickly. And by the way, this is at the most intimate of levels. So officers, interactions, the frontline, social services, whatever it is, the many departments that work that frontline, the treatment of that inmate, as well as administration, which our job basically is to oversee that level of treatment. And guys, that's part of the reason why even death row inmates have all these rights and all these privileges, to make sure that they're being treated fairly. Because a lot of the times they would say, if I'm on death row, I'm not being given the same opportunities as other inmates who are in GP. And believe it or not, even though death row is a close custody unit, it's still a general population unit. So if that makes any sense, you could have different levels of custody within that general population. So having said that, if you're offering the general population a certain privilege, you better make sure that eventually you're able to offer the same to those higher level inmates, like an inmate that would be on death row or inmate that's in a some level of higher control. Would you agree with that, Russ?
For the most part, what you have to look at is the ones on death row, they are of a higher custody nature. So they don't get things that we would, you know, put out to, you know, level threes or level twos. And they're usually, at least at San Quentin, they were in a management unit, which meant basically is they didn't come out of their cell unless they were in handcuffs. And then they were on their way to either visiting, medical, or the yard. And so there were things that they were deprived of. The good thing for them, from their point of view, was those they had unlimited access to the law library. They had really good access to just about everything else that you can imagine, including the fact that they all had TVs in their cells. But we also had a higher level of custody even amongst the death row inmates, which were our grade Bs. And they led a much more austere life in the fact that that what they had to go through as far as, you know, being stripped to go to yard and stuff was on a much higher scale, because they were even more deadly than the regular deadly inmates were, if that makes sense.
Well, yeah. So, Russ, thank you for clarifying that. So basically what I meant was, like, if you have, like, let's say there is law library access, right? And those inmates in death row, you know, for some reason they can't visit that law library, then you better be able to make sure you have a law library for them to access. If all the inmates are getting tablets at that point, because the tablets are going to be, are becoming the function to centralize a lot of needs, like visits, video visits would be a big thing behind that. Sometimes they're putting LexisNexis, the law stuff, on that. When they started implementing tablets, the tablets were like, okay, well, you know, we want to make sure that we're able to implement those to those our inmates in those highest levels of custody, because now those tablets are becoming also ways to put in grievances and stuff like that. So again, you're not, you want to make sure, unless there is a restriction based on safety and security concerns, if you can implement something at the lower level status, like video visits or whatnot, for an inmate that's in death row, who's never going to leave death row. So no matter how good their behavior is on death row, they're never going to leave death row. They may start to have a case on, we want these things too. And then you're going to have to justify why you cannot give it if you decided not to, which would be based on whatever you feel those safety and security needs are. Joe, have you ever worked in a death row unit?
Yeah, I did. I did briefly for a little while as a temporary duty. It's a whole different culture there. You know, as far as working those style pods with death row offenders, you know, I'd say 80% of them act like, you know, normal convicts, just want the normal things that they're supposed to get, which is a lot more scrutinized than your general population or your ad seg inmates. You know, but generally it's a two-way respect. You know, you don't go in there dragging them on them or anything like that. And, you know, as far as what they're entitled to, they, you know, the death row offenders, they get recreation time just like everybody else. You know, it's mostly an indoor rec or an outside guarded pod, fenced in area. Don't know if they've gotten tablets yet back there or not, because tablets were just starting to get introduced into our system as I was retiring. So not quite sure if they've gotten that level yet, but they have access to everything that a normal convict has access to. Their law library stuff is delivered to them, to their cell by the law library. You know, they get fed most of the time, they get fed in their cells. And, you know, they get their daily recreation, showers, necessity change, just like, you know, just like everybody else does.
Right. So I want to get to a few questions that we have that are coming our way, because we do have a few. I want to get to Dawn first. So we were talking about the inmate Brian, the one that killed the four individuals in Idaho. And basically now he's in the jail in Monroe County waiting for to be extradited back over to Idaho. And basically the question is, where are they going to keep this Brian? So I'll go first with this, and then I'll have you guys comment if you don't mind. So when you have an inmate like that that's high profile, the moment they go into a jail, they're going to be evaluated. And I want to mention something for the people that are working in the jail. That initial intake matters, because that's the initial info that we're getting on this inmate. And I will guarantee you, no matter where they go from that point on, they're going to want to know what that information was on that initial intake. And what you're going to do on initial intake is you're doing everything. You're doing fingerprints, identity. You're checking medical, which is a big thing. Mental health. I mean, you're really making the evaluation to make sure all those needs are met. You also would try to ask for emergency contacts. You know, you're going to need that as well in case, God forbid, something does happen to this inmate. You know, who you're going to contact, who's the next of kin. And then what's going to happen here is there's going to be a decision made as to where can we place this inmate that is either, one, you know, safe for the facility, yes, but, you know, also safe from other inmates, safe from himself. Now, for an inmate that this is that this high profile, what you're going to wind up doing automatically, in my case, what I would do as administration, I don't care what mental health says or not. I'm putting this guy on some level of administrative constant watch, because my big thing is, now I know we talked about on the show that he didn't know he was escaping from a crime or running away. Supposedly he just made it to his family house without knowing that the police were after him, but we would still see that as an escape. The guy left Idaho, went over to Pennsylvania. So definitely if someone's escaping from something and they get caught, they're going to get put on a constant watch immediately, because you have that freedom that was just taken from them. So imagine that. You're on a high because you think you're going to break away from the law, and you're on a high with that level of freedom, and you know this person wants that freedom. And usually people that escape could be all out, all or nothing. And then when they finally get caught, you know, we don't know if they, you know, if they're going to quickly adjust to the prison life, or if they're, you know, that loss of freedom, and, you know, is that going to affect their decision to, you know, maybe off themselves. So right off the bat, you're going to put that person on a constant watch. Mental health, they're going to interview them to look for any answers that can relate to something actionable in regards to if this person is going through these things mentally. He just, you know, got charged with this crime. It's high profile. You know, they're going to ask him questions about how they feel, how he feels about it, and they're going to look for things that are actionable. Does this person pose a risk to themselves or others? Now, most likely, if the inmate plays the, you know, game, I'm fine, I'm not going to hurt myself, blah, 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 blah. Mental health may say, well, you know what? The person's saying all the right words. There may be no need to put them on a constant watch. Having said that, administration can override that and say, you know what? I don't care if the person's saying all the right words. I'm going to go ahead and we're going to initiate the policy on the constant watch, and we're going to make it administrative. But also be advised, mental health also knows that situational concerns matter. So if the inmate is saying all the right words, mental health may still want to have that universal precaution and then go ahead and put that person on constant watch. Now, mind you, why that person's on constant watch, and if it's definitely a mental health constant watch, you can't clear them to go to court unless mental health and medical clear that individual to go back into the courts, because if the person's on a constant watch, they're not mentally stable. So everything they say at that court, if you wind up releasing them too early without the clearance, really is not going to count for much and will open up for a lawsuit later on if the inmate decides to challenge a former decision they made. Like, well, all of a sudden, I don't want to be extradited. Well, okay, but you said you would. Yeah, but I said it when I was in duress. You know, I was on a mental health constant watch. They pulled me out of the constant watch, and next thing I know, I'm in court. So having said that, the administrative constant watch is a bit different, because that's an administrative constant watch. That's not a mental health constant watch, and that doesn't require clearance from mental health. That would require clearance from administration. After that point, if by chance he does get cleared, you're going to want to put that inmate in protective custody. It would probably be a non-congregate setting, which means that the inmate himself will not be around other inmates, because there's usually two forms of protective custody, guys. One is going to be a non-congregate setting where you have all inmates that are PC, but they're placed kind of isolated from each other. And the inmates that they have very, very limited to no interaction with any inmates. Most of their interactions is going to be with custody professionals or, you know, departmental, like social service, like the correctional staff. The other side of that all is going to be those that are congregate. So when they're congregate, they're going to be PC, but they're going to be placed with other PC inmates, which give them a chance to interact. Now, by the way, guys, when you start doing congregate interaction, there should always be a level effort that you're trying to push this person into some level of GP. But for this guy, Brian, he's going to be PC non-con. And I will guarantee you, once he gets to Idaho, because this case is so famous and just so notorious, he'll probably be PC non-con for the rest of his duration once he gets committed to state. What's your thoughts on all this, Russ?
I really think that probably that local jail there is probably going to farm him out. I say that from the viewpoint of all the things that you mentioned eat up a lot of resources. And when you eat up a lot of resources inside a very small county jail like that, they're not going to want to deal with it. So chances are they'll find some sort of safekeeping for him to be held in, probably at either a much larger county jail or at a prison potentially. So that it's just kind of, you know, dependent on that, because, you know, if you have, you know, limited manpower, and you're talking about, oh, well, we're going to assign someone to watch this guy 24/7. Well, suddenly, you know, you've eaten into a sizable percentage of your manpower just by doing that one action alone.
Yeah, and I got a couple of questions coming in, so let me see if I can get Joe to answer one real quick. Hey, Joe, this comes from Joey Brooklyn. Is it true that a death row inmate can have whatever they want as a last request? I believe there's a cost. There's an amount, right?
Well, in our state, the answer is just straight across no. Several years ago, we had a high-profile inmate who ordered a bunch of food. And I mean, it was an ungodly amount of food, and the state got it. He never touched a drop of it, and then he was executed the next day. One of the state senators got wind of that, and Senator Whitmire, I believe his name is, he's over our legislative budget board, got a hold of that and put a stop to it. So now in Texas, whatever is being served in the chow hall that day is what they get as their last meal. No ands, ifs, or buts.
Yeah, and I also want to add, outside of getting those last set of visits, I mean, obviously, you know, which I actually think is more for the family, you know, to get the family to get their closure. I know some cases in death row where they do get a menu, but it's a very specific menu, and they can only order from that menu. So I know that the TV has a lot of crazy things, like they get this last meal and all this other stuff, but I think there's also budgets, too. I know one facility that allows the inmate, I think maybe only $20, and that's the budget for a death row inmate. So if they do allow the inmate to order out, they can't just order crazy stuff. They can order within a confined, with a certain budget. Russ, what's your thoughts on that as well, just to get that in?
Yeah, as far as I know, that's pretty much the way they do it in California Department of Corrections still. We had a hiatus of over 30 years between executions once when we came back in and we were about to execute Robert Alton Harris. And I believe his last meal was Kentucky Fried Chicken. So there was, you know, there it was a limit with, you know, very you know, set parameters on, you know, where it could come from and how much it could be and the amount, because somebody has to search every bit of that food as it's going through. It's, we don't just let things come through like that. So, I mean, it was ultimately very doable and not completely out of hand. But I do remember that when we were doing that he had Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Yeah, I have a couple of good questions. Joe sponsored a good question from JM. So let me see if I can get to that question here. Hold on 1 second. But I also, hey, Joe, can you do me a favor? You know what I would like to do for this audience? I had one of my first shows I did about 10 years ago, and I always forget his name, and I know you always remind me. He was on my show. He used to work at the Death Row or in Huntsville, like a museum out in Huntsville, and he used to work Death Row. I mean, he executed a lot of inmates, and he was on my show. He talked about the procedure, how it made him feel, and then you told me he's still alive and kicking well.
Yeah, you're talking about Fred Becker?
No. There was another gentleman you mentioned. Somewhere out of Huntsville.
Oh, God. Yeah, now his name just slipped my mind. Yeah, he's still alive and kicking. Still part of the Texas Prison Museum.
Do you think you can reach? Because I forgot his name, but he'll come on the show because he promotes the museum that he runs.
Give me just a second. I should be able to pull his name up.
Yeah, so you said JM had a good question. I got it right here.
Yeah, his question.
I have it.
You got it? Okay.
Yeah, so this may be a stupid question, but how difficult is it to be a correctional officer, having all walk of life and different religions and gangs? That's a great question, by the way, from JM. So let's do this. Joe looks that up. Russ, you want to answer that, Russ?
Sure. I don't think it's, you know, necessarily the gangs or religions or different walks of life that makes what we do so tough. It's really kind of, you know, the day in, day out stress of it all and the things that we have to act upon and react to. Those things that are gangs, they're kind of, you know, a given set of variables that we deal with all the time. That doesn't mean that it's easy. It doesn't mean that it's not dangerous, but it's one of those things that you kind of get used to. You know, I loved what I did for all of those many years, and I still love the fact that I'm attached to it now and that I still try and, you know, reach out and help individuals that are either just getting into it or they need some help along the way, because I think that I've got something to say that will help them in those endeavors because it is so difficult. So, you know, all I can say is that for me, I loved every minute of it, or most minutes of it that I'll say, and that, you know, it's a worthwhile endeavor. And I don't see those things as necessarily, you know, being the showstopper, at least not for me.
Right. And then, hey, Joe, what's your thoughts on that question? That was the question that you pointed out.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I wouldn't say it's a hard walk of life, but it's a different walk of life compared to your most normal jobs. You know, it's all on how you carry yourself. You know, when you get to being a correctional officer is just like going to any other job. You know, things that have outside influences outside your job, regardless whether it's politics or whatever the case may be, you generally keep that to yourself. You know, working in and amongst around gangs was probably one of the best interactions I ever had in my career. Cause you know, it definitely teaches you a lot about the gang life and about the gang, the memberships and hierarchy and stuff. You learn a lot of things about the gangs. You know, as far as, you know, the walk itself, I mean, it's a job just like any other job. It's all in how you carry yourself, you know, how you treat others.
Yeah. So, you know, what's funny. So we're actually putting together a newsletter, try to motivate staff. You know, as we go through changes, and it's tough with changes because we get people that are very resistant because they've gotten comfortable with what they know. So when we try to implement changes, what we do is we don't look for what's not working. We look for what is working and try to gain momentum in our effort to move things forward. And I think correctional staff in general deal with the stress of the moment, the anxiety of what's to come next. They're understaffed, they're overwhelmed. And then there's little to no recognition or even worse, no appreciation for what they do. So in an effort, what I've been trying to do recently is build some level of connection. And how we do that is by looking inwards and finding the value behind what you do. And most of the value does come with the interactions that you have with the other individuals that you deal with, whether it's the inmates, whether it's your staff, whatever it was. So for me, I felt it very interesting because I didn't really know how much I didn't know about the world until I interacted with the inmate population, you know, because their social acceptable behavior is a lot different than ours. But you do see some that strive to meet our expectations. And by the way, that's kind of how I ruled my ship. Before I would go ahead and tell the inmate the rules to try to get them to follow the rules, I would first give them expectations. So, you know, build in from yourself first. You know, these are things that we expect of you, and it's kind of like meeting your standards. You know, because you're trying to build up from within. If I had to, then I would go ahead and issue the rules if they didn't comply with the expectations. But I will tell you one thing. One of the biggest moments I remember in my career is actually an interaction I had with an inmate in regards to I was new to the profession. I had a female who had just came in from county. And as soon as she came in from county, when she was placed into one of the dorms, she got into a nice fight, took out a few of the other females, and then basically thought that's who she needed to be. As we were escorting her to the holding area before she gets hurt on her charges and then whatever the outcome is of that, this girl was stoned. I mean, she was quiet, literally just did what she thought she had to do. This whole journey taking her into lock. I happen to work a double that night, so I go ahead and I have the unit that she was now placed in, which is a pre-hearing detention unit. It's a unit that's utilized to hold an inmate for institutional charges until it's discovered what the outcome of those institutional charges are. So it's kind of like a court system within a jail within a jail, let's say, but the whole sort of court system. So as I'm doing my rounds, I do hear this female. She's crying. She's upset. So I actually stop, check by the cell. Now she's in the back of the cell. And I remember telling her, now, by the way, it's a moment for me because I'm still new to this career and I'm trying to figure out who I want to be. Because that's a big part of this profession. You have to go in knowing who you want to be and basically trying to have a North Star. Because if not, and you come in with this profession and it's passive, it could destroy you. You have to be intentional with this type of career. You have to look to grow every day and try to find moments of value. Because in the end, when you're dealing through all this bullshit, if you just connect it to an external incentive like pay or benefits, you're going to say, well, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. But if you find something of value, then the comparison's a little bit better. It's like, okay, you know what? I could do this because this will be worth it. So I tell her, because remember now, I saw the extreme of her. I saw where she was quiet, stoned, and basically made her mark. Well, on the other side of that, this was the softer side. So I witnessed two extremes. So somewhere she's in the middle, you know, that's who she needs to be. So I remember telling her, hey, it's good to feel what you're feeling right now because that's telling you that you don't want to be in this place. That's telling that you want to be someplace better. Now, mind you, this stuck with her for however many months until I wind up seeing her again when I was at a mess hall. She heard my voice. She comes out and she says, are you Officer Ganji? And I said, yes. And she goes, you told me advice 6 months ago that's really stayed with me. Now, mind you, I want to provide an ending to the story. This inmate never asked me for anything throughout my whole career. So it's not like she was setting me up. And by the way, I never trust an inmate either way, so I'm always on guard. But having said that, I wanted to put that at the end of the story. So, you know, people are like, oh, she was just setting you up. No, let me just explain this. So she went ahead and she said that in her life, no one had ever given her the expectation of doing something positive like that. Like basically you're better than this place, where in her life, you got recognition for stealing a car. You got recognition for beating up a fellow gang member. No one ever came up to her and said, hey, you could be something better. So I started this thing with her where I said, well, you know, it's about expectations. You know, these are the things I would expect of you, just like these are the things that you would expect of me. But I think with expectations, it gives the person a chance to meet those expectations. And I saw her every day trying to meet those expectations. I did. But now, mind you, she's in an environment that may not be so supportive of it. But I saw the struggle. I saw her going back and forth daily, you know, to meet those expectations. Never once did I ever have to enforce the rules with her, because the expectations for her meant more to her because she was doing it for herself, as opposed to me saying, well, these are the rules. Because at that point, you're not doing it for yourself. You're doing it for either me or the facility. So the expectation kind of says you're doing this for you. And I will say, to make the, you know, to come to the end of the story, is that she never went back to the prison. Once she was released, she never came back. So having said that, I could see the struggle of someone trying to do the right thing in a world that may push them to do the wrong thing. So I sat there like, you know what's funny, guys? You know what I realized? And maybe I'll ask Russ this question as well, and Joe. Common sense to us, based on our experiences, we kind of figure what we believe to be the right thing to do. And that's filtered through our evaluated experiences, our biases. And at the end of the day, this is the end result. This is our common sense. For them, it's a different level of experiences. It's a different level of experience that have been evaluated. It's a different level of bias. So when they wind up thinking through what they got to do and they wind up making decisions, it may not be the right decision. So as someone that's into rehabilitation, you got to correct that mindset that brings them to that impulsive decision. And Russ, you're working with juveniles, Russ. I mean, what's your thought on that?
Yeah, when you look at, you know, the way that they look at things versus the way that we look at things, whether it's juveniles or just, you know, your average antisocial personality type, they really are. Their expectations about life have no judgment place for society to pass judgment on them. They just consider that what they're doing is normal for them. Even though they live outside the bounds of things that we would consider shocking. So part of the way you put a person like that back together again is to give them expectations and to hold them accountable for the way society sees things, not for the way that they see things. I mean, to them, you know, it's a snitches get stitches and all those other things that come along with that mental mindset. There are ways that these people can be fixed, but it's only those on the margins that can be fixed, unfortunately. We're able to, you know, actually tilt the percentages only by a few points, even by doing really great work out there. You know, it's, you know, somewhere between, we're like successful between somewhere, you know, 30 and 35%, and we consider that good.
Yeah, can I add something too before we get to Joe? Guys, you know what the jail or prison system does do? And I believe there's someone here that right here, JM, says that's awesome. They're an advocate for homeless and drug addicts. Can I mention something? And I think they're going to relate to this. Our job is to help the inmate to some extent. And I believe we all have a part of that. I believe that, you know, custody is starting to also figure out their way in that, because for a while, it was, you know, safety and security. That was paramount. And they said, no, you got to do something. You got to rehabilitate inmates. You got to start bringing them into society. So then the rehabilitation model came in. And it's like, hey, guys, at the end of the day, it's a balance of both. There is no rehabilitation without safety and security. And I think right now custody is trying to figure out their way in navigating that, because we are a part of that. I don't care what anybody says. You know, custody is a big part of helping these inmates succeed by even at the lowest of levels, facilitating, helping the programs to facilitate, getting the inmates to where they need to be. Our job, I think, is when inmates develop bad habits, our job technically as service providers in some sense is that we want to make sure that we make the bad habit harder to get to and the better habits easier to get to. Because you have to realize something, this is going to be an inmate's default, or this is going to be their default setting. We also want to do another thing, which I think is kind of similar to the final step of an AA or an NA group, is we want to give that inmate a chance, once we know that they turned around, to have an influence on maybe another life in general, whether it's bringing their, maybe if they have kids, bringing their family in, bringing their kids. Because we find that the best way to help someone rehabilitate is to, I know this may sound scary, but it's true, is to have them help someone else. You know, we have inmate mentoring programs. So here's the thing. If I mentor, let's say, Russ or Joe, I have to live to those standards, you know, so I can't fall back. So having said that, having that as another option. So while you're going through this, we also want to give you the chance to have an impact on someone else's life. That truly does matter, but it's a process, because at the end of the day is you can offer a lot. I mean, we do. Here's the funny thing, guys. Corrections offers a lot more than most people will think. The only problem is you can't force people to take it for those right reasons. And the sad thing is sometimes when we're doing our rehabilitation programs, you have inmates that are in there for the right reasons, doing the right things, and you could see it because it's actionable. It's actionable. But sometimes we get quotas, or we have to get somebody in because they're up for parole and they have to take this program. It's like, well, the guy was locked up for 20 years. You could have took it 20 years ago. Nope, we got to get him now. And now you start mixing them in with, you know, people that want to do the stuff, that want to do it for the right wing, right reasons. And you're mixing them in with people that are just going through the motions. And the problem is there's always going to be that conflict. And having said that, what I tend to do is I try to evaluate at the end what the person got from that program, because if I'm going to be signing off on community release or, you know, whatever the case may be, status, a lower level status, one of the questions I ask is, besides what have you learned, can you tell me about what you did and what brought you into the system? And the first thing I'm looking for is a level of responsibility. I'm looking for something that says you're taking responsibility for what you've done. And I'm going to get Joe first, but I want to share a story with you, Joe. I want to share a story with this audience first before I get you on, because I want to get your thoughts on this. I had a guy one time that he was a 30 with a 30. So let me just tell you what that means. That means he has to do 30 years. There's no ifs, ands, buts about it, right? There's no parole for this individual. So the only option this person had to get out to the community a little bit early would be to go through one of the community release programs, a halfway house. If you guys aren't familiar with that, basically a halfway house is a transition from going to a prison or a jail back out into the community. It's a transition. So I remember asking this gentleman, because now mind you, he was a lifer, and I'm making the determination right now if this person is ready to go out to the community. And one of the questions I would ask is, can you tell me what you've done? And he told me what he did. Basically, he was in a gang and he was involved in the drug trade. And basically, when you're in a gang and you're involved in a drug trade, one of the things that you're doing is you're going to be carrying a weapon. Why are you carrying a weapon? Because you got to defend yourself, because other people are going to go ahead and try to rob you. So having said that, these people that are selling the drugs, they have to protect themselves, correct? So now what happened was, when he told this story about what brought him into the system, because he wound up taking out somebody who was coming after his stash. He wound up taking the person's life, killing the person, right? So I asked him a question. The one question I asked him was, do you feel guilty for what you have done, for taking another person's life? Now, think about what I just asked him for a second, though. Think about this. In his mind, because he was a gang member and this person was coming to take his stash, so it was my life or yours, he's in survival mode. So when I asked him, do you feel guilty for taking someone's life? You know, you think, okay, I want the answer for him to say yes, but maybe not, because that could be a lie. Because in his mind, he's in survival mode. So why would he feel guilty for taking someone's life if it was, you know, if I didn't take his life, he would have took mine. What this inmate said was awesome. What he said was, he goes, you know what, Ganji? I don't feel guilty for what I have done, but I do feel responsible for the choices that I made that led this to a point in my life where I had to make that choice. And I thought that was such just an honest answer. And by the way, he's another one that got out and never came back. But Joe, when it comes to rehabilitation, I mean, all because you offer it doesn't mean, you know, they're going to take it.
No, just because you offer doesn't mean they're going to take it. I mean, you got two styles of convicts. You got the repeat offender who keeps coming back because, you know, he keeps paroling out or discharging out back into the same element that brought him back the first time. You got your first timers. But either way, you know, a convict is going to act like a convict until they're tired and they're ready to make the change personally from internal. You can offer all the help, wisdom, rehabilitation you want to, but until that inmate's ready to change themselves internally, you know, it takes time and repetition. You know, we've all dealt with the convicts that come back multiple times and set in their ways. And, you know, it takes time and repetition to get them to see things outside the street life and the street life values. And, you know, you got some people that come to the penitentiary because they made a bad choice. It's their first time they made a bad choice and they come in and, you know, they're resigning to doing their time. They admit to their crime. They know they did wrong and, you know, they want to do positive things while they're there and try to help other people, you know, and there's nothing wrong with having an offender mentor because that's somebody from that walk of life that's bringing fresh ideas and fresh values and fresh perspective to them, you know, and that's a good thing. You know, that's the one thing I've always supported is an offender mentor program, whether it be Alcoholics Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous. When we used to bring the juvenile offenders in for the Scared Straight program, you know, we had those offender mentors that kind of opened their eyes and values. And, you know, and generally in the grand scheme of things, you know, and hell, we're all that way. You know, we're not going to make a change until we're ready inside, until we're ready internally to make our own change. Only then will we accept help from the outside, you know, outside of us to help make that change.
Yeah, and guys, by the way, just to let you know, that's one of the things we filter when possible. We look for inmates that are driven for that internal incentive, because having said that, you could have inmates that are externally driven, and when you ask them why you're taking it, the first thing they'll say is, "I need this for parole," or "I need this to get status," and it's like, okay, but that's not enough reason. But I will tell you one thing: when they go into the program, because sometimes we will have to put them in, they come back and they're happy they took it. So again, the inmate has to be taught to have an open mind, and then you know when you ask them the right questions, like you know what, Gangi, I didn't want to take it. But I'm glad I did. These are the things that I've been able to figure out about myself. Because mind you, guys, the program side is difficult because, you know, you want to run a program that is consistent and conducive to all the inmates' needs. But sometimes you have to deal with the inmates that are the most destructive and you know, that really may not believe in it because you have to make an effort to turn it around. And sometimes the program providers have to choose. It's like, well, I could spend a lot of time on this one individual and really work on them, but I got 30 people right now that I have to get through. So that one person is now, I can't have them in the class anymore. Even though I know they may need my help, I just can't do that because in the process, I got 30 guys that are ready to start moving forward, and I can't spend all my energy on the one. Hey, Russ, did you get that question from Carol Z right here?
It's too small for me to read it, but if you would read it.
Yeah, did you ever have that guy in your prison that killed his pregnant wife and baby? He's still in San Quentin.
Okay. Yeah, Scott. Oh, gosh.
Peterson.
No, not Peterson.
Scott Peterson. I was never at San Quentin when Scott Peterson showed up. He got there, you know, many, many years after I was there. But yeah, he's, I would say, you know, typical of what we see there. You know, he had a case of high notoriety, you know, it made the news every night. And then on top of that, he ended up getting a death sentence. He just went through a bunch of court proceedings, very recently to try and get a new trial. Because there were a bunch of, you know, do-gooder advocates for the inmate population that were trying to say, oh, someone heard that he was out there fishing in the bay, and that's why they dumped the body there. And, you know, I'll just say, it's a big bunch of hooey. They got the right guy. You know, he's still going to end up on, or he still is going to remain on death row. He's probably going to be shipped to a different prison now. California has no interest in carrying out the will of the people with regards to death penalty. Our governor here has disbanded death row, as it were, in spite of the fact that it's still on the books as a legitimate form of punishment. And so they've just decided to, you know, ignore democracy altogether in California.
Yeah, and I forgot that Scott Peterson went to San Quentin. Hey, so Alicia asked a great question. She goes, how much psychology and sociology training is required in correction? Is there any mandatory? Okay, so I do have a degree in psychology. That was my choice. So there are certain things that we target. So basically, right now, we have a lot of inmates that are special needs. I believe that a lot of the correctional facilities have become like an asylum for inmates that are dealing with mental health concerns. So we do have a lot of our officers right now are being trained on dealing with the needs of mental health inmates. And they also develop a good partnership with the service providers that are there on the units working with the officers. And you can actually see there's a great working relationship between the service providers and custody. I will tell you right now, for the officers that work those units, it's hard because the inmates can be very impulsive. They're calm, they're not calm. So having that good connection with the service provider, but I will also tell you the officers that work those units have very, very high tolerance because those inmates are not the easiest to work around. So you don't want the most aggressive of individuals working in those units. You know, don't get me wrong. There are going to be certain things you're going to have to write the inmate up for or charge them, but you also have to realize in the context of the situation, you know, what type of inmate you're dealing with, what type of concerns they have. And I've seen officers work with mental health, and they're the ones that mental health actually uses to talk an inmate down because of the rapport that's being built. And then for other things, I believe sometimes we take classes on like just dealing with antisocial personalities, like inmate manipulation, you know, how basically at the end of the day, if given the chance, you could be seen as just an object. One of the discussions we had in duty, Ron, was people that were smart may not necessarily lean towards serial killing. Bullshit. Some of the most highest level of narcissism, narcissistic people will view somebody as an object. And at that point, they don't give two shits about who you are and what you represent. And by the way, I want to add one more thing. Not a lot of people may know this, but our prisoner jails are not really filled with psychopaths or sociopaths. It's not, I mean, we have them, of course, but it doesn't make up a majority of our facility. Like in my career, and I've worked in four prisons, I could probably count on one hand how many true psychopaths I met or how many true sociopaths. I mean, yes, they've committed a crime that we may say, wow, that's crazy. They must be sick. But there's a difference between that person and what they did, maybe situational, I don't know. But when you're walking amongst someone who's really psychopath, I've stared eye to eye to a few of them, and there's something just not right. They're just void of any level of emotion. But would you agree, Joe, that our facilities aren't really, like a lot of people think in prisons, you're going to see a lot of psychopaths and sociopaths, but I mean, they're there, but it's not our predominant number.
No, it's not predominant at all. It's really not as predominant as people would think. You know, when you watch TV shows, you know, they show you the high profile people because, you know, action sells. But, you know, on an everyday style facility, you know, you're walking around with people just like you, me, and Russ and Ganji, you know, You got your handful of mental health inmates that, you know, you deal with occasionally and, you know, some on a daily basis, but that's because they've kind of, I don't know if you want to call it attached themselves to you, but you know, you're the one they see the most often. So that you're the one they want to deal with, but yeah, to walk in the front doors and automatically think right off the bat, you're going to see high profile serial killers and at every corner. It's definitely not the norm.
Yeah, there's some really good questions coming. So I want to do this question by Christina Benedict.
Yeah, that's goes,
yeah, that's a good one. Then I'll get Chris's next. How do you separate your own feelings about a person and their crime and how you interact with them? Are there situations where you carry those things with you when you leave work? So let me be fair because I have been talking a little bit. Let's get Russ, Joe, and then I'll come back to myself. So, Russ, what's your thoughts on that?
So you've got to understand that, you know, you have a higher level of duty to protect the public and your fellow officers than you actually do yourself. You know, you really have to be able to, I don't want to say, you know, sort out the difference, but you just don't let it affect your capacity for action. Your capacity for action and staying within the bounds of, you know, first of all, duty. Second of all, policy and procedure, state law, and and case law is how you should be making your decisions, not basing them on whatever your shallow emotional whims are. And I hate to use the word shallow like that, but it's just the way that you've decided to deal with them. You know, we have this saying in corrections about, you know, be firm, fair, and consistent. And we're not doing that for the sake of the inmates. We're doing that for the sake of ourselves. Those are our guideposts. Those are our navigational beacons so that we know we are on the right and true path. And we know that the difference between us and the difference between any antisocial personality out there, who's obviously most often an inmate, is that we adhere to those norms in society. And more than that, we cling to actually something that's higher than society generally recognizes by not getting ourselves down in the dirt and straying off of those paths. And I'll get down off my soapbox now.
No. It was well said. What's your thoughts? Because we have a lot of questions coming in. So what's your thoughts on that, Joe?
Yeah, I mean, we're taxed with holding ourselves to a higher standard, you know, being professional. And just like Russ said, you know, being firm, fair, and consistent doesn't always mean the way we treat offenders. It's, you know, the way we perform our job duties. So you should never take anything personal, and you damn sure should never take anything home with you. You know, leave it at the gate. Now, there are times where things do bother you. Yes. Let it bother you for a little while and then let it go. Because if you worry about everything that you can't control, you'll give yourself ulcers.
Yeah, well said. I want to mention one thing too, guys. So when I started this career, I knew eventually it would be an intentional career. It's not going to be a passive career, which means that you can't sit down and let the times get to you. You're going to have to be intentional with, you know, finding something that you can connect to. We talked about that before. For me, it would be horrible if I literally did my day every day judging inmates by what they've done. Now, don't get me wrong. I need to know what they've done for some cases for safety and security, but I have to do my best to separate judgment. Now, be mindful. There are still going to be some that you just can't help because of what they've done, that, you know, there is going to be some level of judgment. But at the end of the day, I also can't allow that to affect my decisions and what I do in that position. I also believe that's made me a better person on the outside, because having said that, you know, let's say, you know, my wife forgets to bring me a piece of fruit that I asked for when she went shopping. Well, it's much easier to forgive her, you know, after seeing the shit I know people could do. You know what I mean? So, you know, in comparison, you know, I think when you see the worst in the world, it opens up your eyes to the best in the world. It makes you appreciate things. Now, don't get me wrong. Some people could reverse that perspective. You know, let's say my dad was abusive, so I become abusive, or my dad was abusive and I rised above it, so I would never abuse my children. I mean, that's all about your perspective. And I think the one key thing here, guys, when you work in corrections, is that you have to always find the positive. And when I mean by positive, I don't mean shift reality. I just mean there's positive there. You know, you just have to look for it, because we can get so caught up in negativity that we get swept in and we become miserable. And then unfortunately that travels from the job on the home. So I make my job intentional. I make my job purposeful, and I make my job to have value, because if I don't, I'm going to be miserable. And that's going to translate down to my family, because at the end, if I do agree with this. If I don't identify with what I do in a positive way, because I'm at my job, obviously a big portion of my life. If I don't identify in a positive way, then when I come home, to be honest with you guys, I'm miserable, because again, this is what I do. This is to some extent who I've become and who I am. So I do think you have to have that some level of separation, because if you don't, you'll never survive it in this career. And if you can't, like if I can't be fair to an inmate because of what they've done, then you got to leave the profession. There's no room for you, because that's the hardest thing that we have to do in corrections, is see past what they've done and give them what they need. You know, and I feel for those that do it, bravo, because it's not talked about a lot, because it is hard to do. Okay, now, Chris. Chris asks a good question. Why is it that there are new people coming into the prison with no experience and then train with the high-risk inmates before going to the academy? All right, Russ, we could have fun with this all day. So let me just mention something real quick. So there are a lot of facility guys. Now, guys, this, for people on the outside, you may not know this. So this is a really good question, actually, for the inside. There are a lot of people right now, a lot of agencies that don't send their officers to academies first. What they do is they have them spend time in the facility. And then what they do is they go ahead and they send them in after a couple of months if they're lucky. But by the way, two things. It's a money grab because they're afraid they don't want to invest in the academy because if the person doesn't make it, they wasted money. Second thing is when that person's in the facility, they're very limited in what they can do. So when an emergency comes, you just look for quantity. Because at the end of the day, I want bodies. So I'm not a big fan of not having the person filtered through the academy just to get a taste of what it is. But having said that, Russ, what's your thoughts on Chris's question?
Yeah, you know, there's a couple different competing things there. First of all, especially with regards to prisons, the highest level of custody that we tend to have are our lockdown units. Inside those lockdown units, you know, you can learn the roteness of the job. And that's not to say that there's not a lot of danger there, because there is. But the number and types of interactions that you can have with inmates in those is pretty limited. Getting out into the more general population areas, in my opinion, you know, whatever those levels are, is the better way to go, because you really have to learn how to talk to these guys. You really have to learn, not only the limits, but the scope of your authority, because we're imbued with some really incredible powers. I mean, we have the power out there to take a life if need be. And so you have to learn how to fill those things out in a way that makes you an effective officer, not a bully. Not a wimp, but somewhere in between, where you're able to shift gears and you're able to wear different hats in order to preserve the safety and security of that institution. So I'm a bigger fan of getting in there and getting in the mix of the general population than I am of just, you know, severe lockdown units. What specifically you're talking about, if that's some specific state or not, I'm not sure about, but that's just kind of my viewpoint on it.
And it's funny because me and Russ had this discussion in the past. I will say this. I'm not for anybody not getting training at some level of the academy to have some foundation before crossing into the facility where you apply what's being taught, like the experience, to the foundation of the academy. If you have a good academy foundation, I still like that partnered with the maximum security facility at first, so you can learn the highest level of practices and work your way down. Because don't forget, you're going to have people next to you that could, if you go to make a mistake, they're there to help you. They're here to cultivate you. They're here to guide you. Unfortunately, because how times have been, sometimes we get a lot of officers that still believe in sink or swim. Like, I'll just drop the keys and then you go run the unit and I'm just going to put my feet up. So that's where it does become a concern. Russ is the advocate for more of the defined interactions that you have with inmate population is going to be greater in a lesser security facility, because they're, you know, and so there's a lot of stuff you can learn there as well. So you have one that's more operational, but then you have one that deals with the inmate mindset. My biggest thing is that the inmates that are in these full min units, they should have their mindset focused on being released. Where the inmates that are in the closer units may have their mindset on what to make things more comfortable. But I do agree with Russ. I think they both have value either way. So it's kind of like that debate we have. So I agree with Russ to some extent. So either way, but I would prefer the higher level security first, because you get the highest level of practices. Hey, Joe, I wanted to ask you, Joe, you have any thoughts on that one question, Joe? Did I give it to you already? Or
no? In regards to this, where you're bringing them into a penal facility prior to letting them go through the academy, I'm not a fan of it at all, period. Mm-hmm. I don't think the penitentiary is a place for any kind of internship. You're opening yourself up to a liability if that person gets hurt. They haven't been through the academy yet, so they don't know anything about the rules, regulations, and policies. It's a recipe for disaster. I mean, it'd be like taking somebody and putting them in a Humvee and putting them out in the middle of the desert in Kuwait and telling them just to sit inside and wait for the bullets to pass by and just watch what I do. You know, I'm just not a fan of it, and I don't believe in it.
Yeah, I had a question from Julie. Hey, Julie, can you ask that question again about GED? I can't find it, so I'll go to Master.
She was asking about who funds the GED college and rehabilitation programs.
Can I answer that real quick or no? So, so basically, there is funding for education. I don't think it's the highest funding at most prisons or jails. I think a lot of funding may be geared towards regular operations, including even the transitional stuff, like what social services provide, the program and stuff. But education does have some funding, just not as big as I like it to be. Federally, it's taken seriously with any inmate that's under 21. They're not given the option to not go to school if they don't have their GED. And that's fun. Try forcing one of them to go to school when they don't want to. But either way, that's our job. We try to motivate them. As for higher level learning, there are stuff that we do. Sometimes we have colleges that volunteer their time and they come to the facility. They teach courses and, you know, inmates could get their degree. I know a big degree by us is theology. That's a big degree that we have a lot of inmates seeking. Business degrees are also big. Also, inmates can do their own correspondence, so we help facilitate that, but they're going to pay for that. The only problem with correspondence courses, guys, to be honest with you, is that it takes – so inmates in the unit, they all share the same resources, like phones and whatnot. So if an inmate has a correspondence and he has to, let's say, you know, we're working with the college, so they understand the inmates are very limited, so we set up some certain deals with – how the inmate can give their work in, or, you know, sometimes there's conversation on the phone, you know, they may need an hour or so, and we can't give them that hour because we have other inmates that need to use the phone. So we usually work with the college and kind of, you know, meet them in the middle somewhere. And then usually the college will be a little forgiving based on what the inmates' circumstances are. Now, this is a good question from Master Roshi. What percentage of offenders in your estimation committed some super atrocious act under the influence of drugs or a temporary mental break, then after that they return to normal, were remorseful? I can go first with this, or I don't know if Russ, but let me just go first with this. In my opinion, and by the way, I'm not using this as an excuse for what they've done, because it's not, but you're going to see that there's a lot somewhere along the line. A lot of people think drug use is really a non-victim crime. The reason why I'm going to disagree with that is, have you ever dealt with an addict that really wants that high and maybe they don't have the money to afford it? They will do anything they can, including hurting somebody or killing somebody to get that fix, you know, get the money, whatever it is, rob them, whatever it is. And it's true. I mean, it's not who that person is. They're chasing something. Now, for me, if you look at most of the inmates' records, you're going to see that some of them may have a drug history. And then what's great about that is, once the facility is able to address the drug history, you know, whatever the inmate was addicted on, whatever it is, once they feel they're secured in that path, then they can work on the impulsive behaviors that related to that. I've seen inmates that have felt extremely remorseful once they had a clean head. But you got to realize a lot of these people that, you know, may be taking drugs, a lot of them sometimes, sorry guys, it is what it is. I'm going to tell you how it is. It could be a very selfish mentality. You know, I want my fix. And if you're in the way of it, watch out. I mean, that's pretty much what it is. If you're in the way of it, watch out. So technically, a lot of them may not be willing to take some level of accountability or responsibility because they're still chasing that high. But once you clear their mind and once they realize like what they were chasing was foolish and these are the things that they did, yes, I've seen people become extremely, extremely remorseful, especially those that were in for DWIs. You know, they just got drunk and they're not really killers. You know, they didn't go out with the mindset, I'm going to kill somebody today, but they made a selfish thought that I'm going to drive the vehicle because I believe I'm okay. And they come home with half a person on their bumper. And, you know, they're going to do time, whatever it is, but they also took a life and they were good people, but they were affected by whatever that choice was. So I do believe that there are some people that do commit atrocious acts and maybe underlying behind that could be some level of drug use. But I also want to mention that there are some people that are controlled by a situation and they act on the situation, unfortunately, impulsively, and then they do their time and they're not really a problem. And then when you go to talk to them, it's really defined by the situation that they were in. They killed their girlfriend because they strayed, you know, so that situation made them act impulsively. I think one of the things that we're able to do in corrections and why, believe it or not, what people may not realize, the criminal justice system does work in this matter. You can't argue this, is that we can stop impulsive behavior so they're not in the community. Until we can figure out what's causing it, we don't want to leave them in the community because they could pose a threat. So our job technically is to deal with the impulsive behavior in a safe and controlled environment. If you have an inmate that's going to kill themselves, the reason why they put themselves on, the reason why we put them on constant watch and we watch them is because we want to have them go through those emotions before they do something impulsive, and then we'll work them down back into GP. But hey, Russ or Joe, I'd like to get your thoughts. Maybe Russ first and then Joe. And do you think a lot of the crimes could have that as the backdrop? Not giving it as an excuse, but saying it could be in the backdrop of most of those choices?
I would say that you know, it can be. But I think you have to look at the bigger, broader context as those crimes affect society, whether there's an immediate violent nexus to it or not. Being out there and having him be and being dependent on a drug and having that as your excuse or reason to sell poison to people. Selling poison to people is a violent act in and of itself. And those people that take that poison and then sell it to others, even more so. And then those that end up, you know, destroying the very fabric of society by destroying the lives of their loved ones, by burning the bridges, by destroying everything that goes on, and then becoming dependent upon society itself to put them through rehabilitation, to make their lives better, to get them treatment for those drugs. I think that what society is going through right now in this instance is a huge disservice, because they've made many of these people completely unaccountable for their actions. There no longer is, for the most part, a stick. There's only carrot. And that's the way it's being presented to them. Oh, well, we want to avoid punishment, so we're only going to give rewards. And I think that that's part of the reason that we've seen the explosive amounts of more homeless on the streets. I know it's part of the reason that we see more and more drug overdoses and fentanyl. You know, we could argue the fact, and I won't go into it a great deal, but just making it, giving everybody a hammock so that everybody, you know, can get their fentanyl and have a nice big stash of Narcan to make everything safe for them, is really antithetical toward getting them to stop. So, yeah, that's a big can of worms to talk about, but that's my viewpoint.
Well, you know what? Wait a second. You made a good point. So, guys, you know that the criminal justice system is so people try to run it as a reward base. So basically, they figured if you reward the inmates, that they would be able to commit to better behavior. And they realized that system does not work. Corrections is run by a loss versus gain. It's been proven time and time again that people are more motivated by a loss than a gain, believe it or not. Oh, welcome aboard, Jess. You know, good to see you. You know, they're more motivated by loss than a gain. So what we do is we run our system on the ability to take away things. Now, the biggest fear we have in corrections is they seem to be making rights, privileges, more privileges into rights. And when that occurs, then staff has a problem with handling control. Because think about it, guys, how do you think staff mitigate concerns in the prison? The inmate acts stupid. I'm going to take away your TV. So that football game you want to watch every Sunday, not going to happen this week. That's because you were foolish. But if you went ahead and said, hey, guys, why don't you be good and I'll get you a pizza party for next week? Inmate's like, I don't give a shit. I don't eat pizza. I don't need it. I live this far without pizza. So you got to affect, you know, if they're being foolish, if they're being bad, the corrective action is really to go after what they're used to. What maintains their lifestyle? People say, well, lifers, if you're a lifer, you have nothing to lose. Of course you do. They have a lifestyle within that prison. So they're the ones that are actually the most behaved, because at the end of the day, they don't want people messing with that lifestyle. If they're a lifer and they get some younger buck coming into the facility being stupid, the lifer regulates them. They're like, yo, my man, my life is good here. I don't want the CO start coming in and ripping my shit up, and you know, because you want to be foolish. So for people don't think that lifers have nothing to lose, they have everything to lose. They have a lifestyle that they've been accustomed to. So I, you know, Joe, what's your thoughts on how the systems run? Do you think it runs better as a reward system where we reward good behavior, or is it run better when we run it as a loss versus gain? Like, you do something foolish, we take it away.
I think it's a little bit of balance of both. You know, you definitely want to deal with the foolish behavior. But at the same time, if you have a convict that's truly trying to change and better himself and goes through his classes, and even goes as far as getting a college degree, yeah, I think that kind of initiative in a penitentiary should be rewarded as well. And we have programs in place for that, for when them convicts get out, job placement programs and things of that nature. But I think my personal belief is I think we should get back to the basics of security and deal with the bad behaviors, because, part of our mission statement is to promote positive change in offender behavior. You can't really do that if you're always handing out participation trophies.
But can I add something that you said? So I agree with you. So guys, let me mention something. The Joe mentioned something that was a good point. Your initial attempt to regulate corrective behavior is going to have to be to take something away. Now, mind you, if the inmate's doing the right thing and they continue to move forward, then it's okay to reward them based – keep that momentum going. I'm not against that at all. I mean, if they want to do some facility initiative and then reward the people that – like extra commissary or whatever, is to reward the inmates for continuing down the right path, yes. But I don't agree with it as an initial attempt to correct behavior. That makes sense.
Ooh. And I'll tell you one thing, Anthony, here in Texas, a couple of months back, they've actually hired their first ex-convict to work on a facility in maintenance. Yeah. That went through, all his programs and got his HVAC license and all that stuff. So, some things are better left undone. And to me, that's one of them. I applaud the convict because he did his time for a DWI that had a serious bodily injury attached to it, not a death, but a serious bodily injury. And he spent his time getting his HVAC license and, had dreams of starting his own business and, TDC hired him to work in the maintenance department doing their air conditioning as one of the job placement programs. So, I applaud the convict for going the stretch that he did to keep himself on the straight and narrow and prevent himself from coming back to the penitentiary.
But so, there's a in that kind of a situation. I mean, we all three of us in this little, digital room here, we already know that there's a big question mark hanging over that, because we know the degree to which people are corrupted and co-opted by the STGs out there and what level of, monetary compensation they could give a guy like that to bring something in. And he's been around them the past, 10, 12, 15 years?
Yeah, so right, Russ, I agree. I want to say something, guys. I'm not cold to I do believe people can change, and I'll tell you why I believe people can change, because I believe the workers. I believe that the people that do the work are doing it for the right reasons. My social services, education, religious, mental health, whatever it is. I don't believe that they would invest time in something that's hopeless. So in return, I have to believe in what they can do. I do. I mean, I was custody, and sometimes we have this us versus them mentality with the inmate population. Like, we're anti-inmate. But the problem is with that is that you wind up becoming anti-social provider, social service provider, or whatever, service provider. You wind up holding the inmates at the same level as the people that try to help them. Now, when you start moving up, you start overseeing those individuals that are service providers. So you cannot hold those individuals in the same light as you're going to hold the worst of the worst inmates. Because, I mean, I have to go into some level and say, you know what? I believe inmates can change because I've seen the dedication behind the people that are trying to facilitate that change. But I do want to say this, though. I do want to say this. Am I comfortable enough of them having coming back to the facility and work those posts? No. And the reason why, it's not because I don't believe in their honest effort to change. My biggest concerns are the consequences that they fall backwards. That's my biggest concern. So I don't want to sit there and say, I don't believe, maybe they'll work 100%, but I don't want to take that risk because there's a greater consequence here if this person doesn't work out. I mean, that's the key. That's like having a guy that, let's say, kill somebody And we're like, you know what? Maybe it was situational. He doesn't need to do time. Just send them back out the community. There's back on the community. Likelihood of him doing it again is it's not going to happen. Yeah, maybe, but I'm not ready for that. I'm sorry. Keep him inside the facility. Have him go for whatever changes he needs within that confined, you know, promise of safety and security. And then when they're ready to get released, they can get released. But having said that, I'm still going to be very wary of where that person goes. And guys, again, it's not because I don't believe in rehabilitation. I do 100%. But I also got to believe that, you know, I got to believe the fact that the consequences matter. I don't want to put people at risk, because at the end of the day, I will tell you one other thing too. Imagine the morale of the people that are doing that job when they notice that person next to them is this. All of a sudden, they start doubting that individual. So it really doesn't set for a good, trusted work environment. There's a good question here, guys. There's a few questions here, guys. I saw it before. Bear with me, guys. I want to where was it? Was it Tina? No, where is it? Hold on. Because the questions are coming in quick. The comments are good, but I want to. Hold on, guys. He had some people from Texas here, Joe. Jeff Crowley or Jeff Crowley. Yeah. Okay, this is the question because it's right before the HVAC. I got it. Half dozen. Where the hell is it? It was right before the HVAC. They asked about the training with the HVAC. I can't find the damn question. It was a good question. I don't know who wrote it. So, okay, look at this. Do prisoners who were successful appearing elite to the outside general public, let's say Ted Bundy types, have the same ability with the incarcerated? How are smug intellectual types treated in prison? That's a fucking great question. That's a hard question. Go ahead, Russ, you go first on that.
Okay. So we all know and have in our own circles people like that, you know, who are smug, who speak to you in a condescending tone, and you know, who take on that aura of elitism about that. And I will say that if you do that in prison as an inmate, you are putting yourself in serious and immediate danger, because that smug look can get knocked off your face real quick by one of these, you know, alpha male STG guys who is out there not only to preserve what he has, but to make sure that he doesn't have to do a lot of fighting in the future. So they look for the easy victories of that person, you know, putting on that smug aura, and will attack them immediately. I've seen it many, many times. And they do that out of a sense of self-preservation, so they actually have to fight less.
Yeah, and I want to mention something too. When you get inmates that could be, you know, I don't know if that's actually a facade, but when you get inmates that try to fake the funk, these other inmates will be able to pick that up because they're going to test them physically. Now, I will say this, though. Some inmates are smart. What they'll do is they'll come into the system and they'll position themselves into an area where inmates can see they have value, like a paralegal. I've seen weaker inmates, including sex offenders. They're good with dealing with the laws. And what they do is they know, like, you know what, man, I'm going to become a paralegal, make the inmates need me. And eventually what happens here is the inmates do need their services. So the inmate puts himself in a very needed position, and the inmates wind up, taking advantage of that, if you will. So I've seen weaker inmates get positions of, I guess, what some inmates would consider prestige, especially like the paralegals. I'm telling you, a lot of those inmates that are in for sex offenses, they're good with the legal things that the inmates are facing, and sometimes they help them get out of the case, you know. So, that was a good question. Hey, Joe, this is a good question. Do you have offenders? Many go into prison without a habit but finish their sentence and leave with one. What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, sadly, there is a small percentage that does happen to, because we all know drugs are very possible in a penal facility. And you may have one that came in without a drug habit and either gets initiated into a gang or hangs with the wrong crowd in the penitentiary. And yeah, there's definitely a remote possibility one may come out with a habit.
I have a very unique story with that. I had a gentleman when I was at the maximum security prison. I was a sergeant, And I actually had more interaction with the inmate population when I was an officer or sergeant than I do now in admin. But I remember this guy. He was I remember his last name and everything, first and last name. He was a Playboy gangster Crip, and young kid, but he was coming in and doing everything correct. I mean, again, you got inmates that may bullshit you, but you got some inmates, you can see that they're doing the right thing. It's actionable. You could see it. This kid was going to school. His schedule was filled with things to do. Barely kept himself in his cell. Anytime there was something he could do, he would jump up and do it. And I would see this guy briefly during the interactions of movement because these facilities are very controlled. So I would be at the point facilitating a movement and the inmates would have to walk through that point to get to, let's say, mess or whatever movement was called out. So I would see a lot of these inmates in those brief interactions as they kept it moving. And, you know, you see the same inmate every day, you know, hey, what's going on? How you doing? Hey, what's up, G? How everything good? Good, good. And they kind of keep it moving. The dialogue is very surface dialogue. It's not like deep dialogue. But through frequency, you get to see the inmate. You get to kind of, you know, build some level of rapport, even though it's a quick exchange. Because, again, you're keeping it going. By the way, you're not asking an inmate for any information during a mass movement. You're just keeping it moving. So I remember I did maybe like 15 years or so. So when I saw him, he was on the back end of that. And then eventually he got released. And when he got released into the community, for a while, he was doing good. The only problem is he had all these things that he did in the facility. He got his degree, got a bunch of stuff. But when he crossed out into the real world, he couldn't land a job, couldn't get anything. And he was trying for about, I know it was months from what I heard. I heard it was months. And then what happened was he wound up robbing a pawn store, and then the owner took him out. Now, with that said, it was funny because I read the newspaper. And the funny thing about working in corrections is when you start reading the newspaper, you start recognizing some of the people that have committed these crimes. And everybody else just, you know, kind of goes through. You're sitting there like, well, I know this guy. How do you know this guy? Fucking working in a prison. He left recently. Fuck. And sometimes you feel a certain way about it. This one I felt a certain way about because I thought that, you know, he had the promise. And then I realized something. And I'm going to tell you guys this right now. This is out to the public right now. Hopefully it gets somewhere. The prison system doesn't fail at trying to transition the inmate. You got to see the stuff that we offer now, even if we're being forced to offer it, we're offering it. It's when the inmate gets in the community and the community doesn't step up. Because this person right here did everything correct. We prepared him. But when shit, you know, hit the fan, what do you do when you go back to survival mode? You go back to what you know. And what he knew was this. And unfortunately, he got taken out. And I know another female did the same thing. She was in the system, you know, young, said she was going to do the right thing when she got out. We had belief that she would. And I remember I was with my wife one day. We're at a store by where I live. I saw her there working. We interacted. It was a positive interaction, just enough to kind of get in and out of the store. And then later on, I found out she went missing. And then after that, they found her body and torso separated because she was, it's in the news, you know, she was tricking or something and she had AIDS and she didn't tell people and she did it to the wrong person. And they're like, well, why? Well, she lost her job too. So she went back to what she knew, which was making money for whatever it is. So again, guys, you know, we make our efforts inside the facility, but sometimes the community doesn't always step up and match those efforts. And real quick, I know it's happened. So the guy, Brian from Idaho, he's requesting a vegan meal. And I did mention that the system will have to give him a vegan meal. Would you guys agree to that? And Russ or Joe, would you guys agree with that?
Well, I agree. I agree that it's most likely that he's going to get it, either due to religious or just, you know, his own personal observations, because they cater to inmates now. That was a thing that was, you know, really starting to come through when I ended up retiring. Was you know, these guys, they would put in and they would want, you know, a kosher meal because they thought, you know, the kosher meal was better. They liked it more. And but the thing was, is then they ended up, you know, having to go be observant, you know, as a you know, follower of Judaism, or a follower of Muhammad, if they were getting the halal meal. And so, you know, we're kind of held to that standard that we have to provide something like that.
to them. So this guy, he's going to get his vegan meal almost certainly. It may come a little bit further down the pike than he wants it to, just depending on where he ends up initially, but he's going to get it.
A lot of it depends on when they first came in the penitentiary, what they were classified in as far as their religion. And, you know, secondly, you know, if they converted while they're in, they, you know, do the full-fledged convert, you know, the vegans are going to get their meals just like the inmate, the Muslim inmates will. And, you know, they're starting to branch out and cater to more different religious groups, you know, Native Americans and, you know, as well.
Convert.
Hey guys, by the way, usually when someone puts in that request, it's going to get approved by, you know, different departments, religious services, medical, depending on what it is. There was a good question here. Where is it? Let me go to the one. Oh, wait, here it is. Wait, let me go to the one at the bottom first. It's hard to find this question by myself here. Inmates will use their religion to manipulate us. Okay, Trish, I'll start off with this, and then I know Russ and Joe are going to jump on this. So I'm going to start off very general real quick, and then I'll have Russ and Joe definitely touching on this, because this could talk of how it falls into gangs and everything too. So I want you guys to think of this. Anytime an inmate has a right? Anytime they have a right, so let's say religion is a right, they know that's something that we're very limited in what we can do in regards to affecting those rights. So a lot of them will utilize their rights to manipulate something for their benefit. So I'll give just one example. You could have a lot of inmates saying that, you know, we're Muslim and we have to meet here. And then when you do the investigation, you find out, yeah, they may be Muslim, but they're not meeting here for Muslim purposes. They're meeting here to facilitate their needs for the gang. White supremacists, maybe even facilitate their needs to what the Thor religion,
Odinism,
you know,
yeah.
The white supremacists may find themselves saying that they're practicing Odinism, which, you know, again, you know, you cannot deny them that because it's their right. So one thing about rights is that I'm not saying, we don't, you know, follow through with those. If they're their rights, of course they get to have them, but a lot of inmates will manipulate that. Look about mail is a legal mail. Is a right. Male in general is a right, and they'll take advantage of that because sometimes some of them will have drugs coming in. Not all, because guys, I'm not speaking for all, but when it comes to the rights of inmates, we always have to be wary that some will take advantage of those rights. And I will tell you one thing right now. If I had an inmate that I thought was manipulating religious services to meet up with a gang, by the way, that is his right, is to go to religious services, okay? But if I have reason to believe that he's doing it because he's trying to meet up with his gang, I have to go through a whole mess of stuff before I can even think about removing that inmate from that religious service, because it's his right to be there if he doesn't pose a safety and security threat. So if I can't prove it, I just know it. Like, I think they're doing it, but I can't prove it, but I have a feeling they are. It's almost impossible to stop that inmate from going there until, sadly to say, something could happen. And then it's like, man, I knew it.
It is easy to put them out, because if you notice that they're coming down there and congregating, they're talking during service with each other, and they're, you know, they're being boisterous, or they're being bluntly out front that they're not even interested in the service because they're talking amongst each other, boot them out.
Yeah, but most right, Joe, but I'll be honest with you, most of the time the ones that are doing it, like, let's say they're planning something, most of the time it's just for them. Guys, real quick, let me just mention something real quick, because Joe's right. Chaplain services, stuff, you always have to be wary of where there's centralized services or centralized functions, like religious service could require inmates from different units to go to that one area. Food, where you serve ODR, that could be a centralized area. So sometimes if that's where the inmates are meeting and they're doing something illegal, they may not be boisterous. They may do it very quietly. They don't, you know, cause a alarm. You just know. And then the problem is, if sometimes I'll talk to the religious provider, like Joe said, and said, you know what, hey, this guy, you know, do me a favor. Doesn't even look like this guy's paying attention to the sermon. It looks like he's, you know, doing something over here. Can you help me out? Can you, as a provider, write me something so I can use that to lean on to get that guy out? Because I have a feeling they're not here for the religious practice. They're here to serve some illegal function. But you're right, Joe. I mean, but those people don't usually make themselves evident like that.
Yeah. I mean, and sometimes they do, sometimes they don't, because, you know, they feel that, you know, there's not going to be a security presence there in the chapel while services are going on. And I used to make sure that, you know, I had an officer standing at the back of that chapel keeping eyes on. And I tell them, hey, if you catch them congregating and grouping up over there in a corner and doing their own thing instead of listening to the services, put them out. Put them out. Identify them and put them out. This way, number one, I'm going to put them on an STG watch list. You know, because if they're there for true religious services, you know the difference between the ones that are and the ones that aren't. So, you know, there's more than one way to skin a cat when it comes to that.
And STG is security threat group, so that's really just the gang side. Hey, Russ, what's your thoughts on this? What do you think of how the prison jail that's run in Arizona, they live in tents, no coffee, pink underwear, and only get to watch the Weather Channel?
Joe, no, I say good for them. Good for if they're continuing on that after this long after Joe Arpaio has been gone from there. You know, there's no reason to incentivize making jail into a hammock, if you were. I think that we can do those things for those inmates. I think that we can still provide potential, you know, rehabilitation and reentry work with them. But there's no reason to just make, you know, life on the inside that much easier. I think too often, you know, I see guys that say, hey, you know what, I'm tired of being homeless. And I know that I can't go in and smoke crack or methamphetamine all the time, but I can do it part of the time because somebody will come in and bring some, or I'll take my own in. And so I think, you know, it's a way to disincentivize bad behavior. So I'm all for it.
Yeah. So I want to answer this question by true crime. So basically, other than religion and basic human rights, there should be no other rights. I'm sorry. Okay. So I'll just real quick, obviously medical, mental health, the basic human rights, shelter, food, because don't forget now, yes, they put themselves there. So 100% they put themselves there, but we're control of their arrangements, why they're there, and the liability of not meeting those needs. Now, believe it or not, visits is a right, but whether they're contact or non-contact is where it becomes a privilege or not. So, like, if I'm a visitor and I decide to do something foolish and smuggle something in, the inmate will get in trouble. Maybe they'll lose contact visits, but they may still be entitled to window visits. And the reason why that's the case is it's been proven that family is a good part to rehabilitation as long as they're doing the right thing. Now, that person that smuggled something in, they're banned for life. That's the choice you made. Sorry, man. You were the mother of the child. Sorry, not coming back. You know, now I'm not saying that can't be looked at later on, because sometimes we say banned for life and then a couple years later, the person winds up coming back. But it's not an easy process. And most of the time, what I've seen is you do it once. That was your opportunity. There's a zero tolerance for that. So the inmate may go back to getting contact visits later on, but never with that individual. And if they decided to soften up because, you know, let's say that was the mother of the child and she needs to bring the child in, well, then what you could do is you always filter that to a non-contact visit to eliminate their interaction. Mail is something that we can't mess with either, especially legal mail. That's going to have to be opened in front of the inmate, looked at.
That is changing, though, too, in the way that they're delivering mail services. A lot of these jails, the one that I'm at now, is all of the jail services, the mail is put on a kiosk screen for them to see, and they never get to touch it. So, you know, hard lessons learned.
Yeah, and guys, you know why that started? Russ is 100% correct. That started because inmates, you know, found a way to use the mail system to smuggle in, you know, things like Suboxone or fentanyl.
Methamphetamine, the whole range.
And guys, I mean, some crazy stuff here, guys, is they'll have, like, you know, family members will color a picture, and then you got to go underneath the picture, like chip through the crayon to look for that little hint of yellow. And I'll tell you something, the staff that worked the mailroom, the officers in custody, the supervisors, bravo, because that is one of the biggest points of entry for contraband. And it is not an easy job because they become so inventive with the stuff from how you could smuggle stuff into the mail. That's why if you have certain facilities that just allow an inmate to order from anywhere or let the family give them anything, it makes it harder for staff because, like, yo, this guy can get stuff from everywhere when we usually have approved vendors. You know, these are the vendors you can order from. And the reason why is we've built a relationship with them, and not saying it's 100%, but there's some level of trust in how the procedure works and what's expected. But the mailroom is a very important part of correctional operations, but it's also a part that we have to do a little bit better on when it comes to controlling the contraband. Like Russ said, there's some facilities now that only give inmate paper copies. Photocopies of their mail. They don't give them the originals because for a while, and Russ or Joe could touch on this real quick, fentanyl was coming through the mail and it was taking officers and inmates out like candy. Right, Joe?
Yeah. Yeah. It was bad. God almighty, you know, and then the civilian mailroom staff as well, you know, and what kills me about the whole process was, you know, it wasn't so much the fentanyl. It was the fact that, you know, family members of these offenders, you know, baby mamas, whatever you want to call them, were sending in pictures of their kids soaked in meth, you know, and, you know, you find a guy eating a damn picture, you know, getting high. It was disgusting. It was disheartening. But, you know, the mailroom has a tough gig because I'm telling you, in Texas, it had gotten to the point where we had drug dogs at the mailroom. As soon as the mail was delivered from the post office, the drug dogs were there going through the mail. And I mean, the amount of hits of that dog, it's unreal, you know. And there's been a couple of comments on there about, they honestly can't understand why these guys are being given internet privileges and tablets and this, that, and the other, you know. From a penitentiary standpoint, we're looking at it as a security option, you know. Letting them have visits on the tablets and letting them get pictures of their kids on the tablets versus contraband coming into the facility, either by person or by mail. You know, it's to me, I wasn't happy about it at first either, but then it made sense. You know, it's less chance of contraband coming in. At the same time, you know, most of these guys are able to get local TV channels on some of these tablets, and you know, most of these guys won't even come out of their cells now because there's no reason for them to come to the day room to watch TV because they got their tablet. So it's kind of a win-win for the offender, and it's a win for the officer walking that pod. But, yeah.
And, guys, I don't think it's open access to the internet. It's very controlled.
No, it's very.
Yes, it's supposedly controlled, but, you know, there are places already that, you know, have found these devices that have been allegedly, you know, jailbroken. I know of devices that have been found that have been lookalikes, you know. You got to understand that there is a lot of money in a lot of different things. There's in prison, there's money in drugs, there's money in contact, there's money in porn. All of these things. So, you know, I think the idea that we can just rely on the provider to, you know, back up that security aspect, I think we need to be more proactive all the time.
Right. So I think, like, so I don't know how some facilities operate, right? So you're right. Obviously, there's hackers. But I'll give you an example. Some of the internet we have, the only time they get access to it is if it's needed to complete a function. I'll give you an example. A lot of the tests that the inmates take for school are done through the internet now. So what they'll do is, you know, and you have to have the internet function. So what they do is they'll bring the inmates in to take the test, their schedule, and you have custody there watching their access to make sure they're not venturing off. The only time when that becomes a problem is if I got a sex offender under Megan's law who's not allowed to use the internet for education. You know, they just, it's a ban, zero tolerance ban. They can't use it. Then it's like, well, we have to find out another mean. To facilitate that need. And guys, granted, where you work prisons, you have to be fair. So I know somebody like sex offender, what do you care? I have to be able to care because they can easily get a lawsuit saying they're being treated differently because they can't get whatever degree it is because it's an online degree. And here's the sad thing, guys, the way the world works, if there's one obstacle, people will lift the obstacle regardless of the consequences. That's the scariest thing. Because they're more afraid of the lawsuit. Next thing you know, they start giving sex offenders back internet access because they're so concerned about them getting that education. So again, you know, it's something that I know is monitored, but I know like for where I work, they don't get like, I mean, you're right, they could hack it, but they don't get access. It's like your access is for the video visit. If you try to venture off, the computer locks you. It's done. But you're right. You never know if that. So here's another question. listening to how the inside of the jail actually works. Well, what is the difference between jail and prison and penitentiary? That's a good question. I'll give this one to Russ. Get it, Russ.
Okay,
bring out your PowerPoint, Russ. Bring out your PowerPoint.
No. So just the way to think about basically is jail is a local level event. It is what happens when someone is, you know, being held and detained for a crime, for a trial, waiting to be sentenced. And then prison is basically everything that happens after that sentence is implemented, assuming it is more than 1 year in duration, except for in California where we're at, where it's, if it's more than 3 years in duration. There may be some other states now that have changed those around a little bit, but for the most part, it has to be a felony and it has to be more than a year in duration, and then you end up in prison. So the jails, for the most part, feed the prisons their stock of inmates that are, you know, obviously higher degree of security type of inmates, because they've committed, you know, ostensibly more serious crimes, and that they're having more time to do. When you're sentenced to something that happens in jail, it's generally less than a year, unless you're in California. It tends to be, you know, felonies that have that lower level and misdemeanors. Now in, to a lesser degree in California, but in some states like New York and so forth, they don't even have such a thing anymore as pre-trial detention unless you kill somebody. So there's a lot more crimes occurring out there in the streets, but that's basically what the difference is.
And hey, John, I thought maybe you could attack this question real quick for Master Roshi. If someone comes in addicted to alcohol opiates, is there medication that they can get to medically detox? I know alcohol DTS can kill as well as Xanax. Withdrawal in opiates is hell on earth to stop.
Well, that process is conducted long before they come to the Texas penitentiary. Chances are that they've undergone that process while they were at a county jail, either waiting on trial or waiting on a bed at a TDCJ facility. By the time they get to us, that's pretty much a done deal. The only thing the only thing we'll treat is if they have any kind of health side effects, you know, issues going on with the liver or, you know, whatever the case is. But as far as detoxing meds, no, that process is pretty much done and over by the time they get to us.
All right. So now to go show you. So now corrections, by the way, guys, on a national level is very inconsistent in their practices. I mean, it really is based on funding. Some facilities, you know, basically they have certain measures in play and other facilities don't. A lot of facilities have moved toward this a MAP program, which is a medical assisted treatment program, like a Suboxone program. And, you know, the problem with some of these programs, especially at the prison level, let's say you're out of jail. I get the jail because it's intake. You got people coming in. They should be, you know, they could be coming from the streets. They could be dealing with addictions and whatnot. And you don't want them to go through withdrawal, because the biggest thing is, besides the withdrawal being considered torture, if you just sit there and allow it to happen without treating the individual, people do die from withdrawal. So it becomes a necessity for the department to step up and say, yo, we got to do something, because we got to eliminate the effects of withdrawal. And usually it's something slow, like, as I said, medical assisted treatment. You start the person on it, but it's always an effort to wean them off. I mean, it's not supposed to be done indefinitely. It's supposed to be an approved program that goes this amount of time, and it's approved by mental health, medical, and administration, and probably custody at some point, because, again, you have to facilitate that need. Now, with that said, when you get to the prison level, unfortunately, I wish we could say that we're 100% drug-free, and we're not. So you could have inmates that have been off drugs that get reintroduced. And unfortunately, then we have to start the process over again. But biggest concern we have right now with this is the fact that we're starting the process. Our numbers are growing, but they're not lessening. That's the problem, because we're not giving them an end game. And you have an inmate that could be on Suboxone for years that's now in the community programs. And now they got to deal with it. And then eventually, once they're out of state custody, who's going to pick up on that? You know, the inmate is now no longer being taken care of by the state. So then it's the same thing with inmates that have mental health concerns. You know, you got an inmate that has a mental health concern. He's being treated by every possible department in corrections. They get released to the community, and to some level, you know, if it's a transition, there's some still some involvement, maybe community release or whatnot. But eventually they go right back into, let's say, the home, and they're not covered, and everything falls back into that cycle again, you know? So the transition part of it all somehow gets lost. It's like we kickstart a lot of these things, and then they lose its relevance as the inmate gets closer and closer to the community. And by the way, some facilities will keep track of an inmate for maybe a year to three, because that's the most likely time they're going to recidivate. Hopefully after that, they don't. But the biggest concerns we have right now with that too is just the manpower. And also when an inmate, especially from a jail level, because they have the biggest amount of traffic going in and out, they're trying to facilitate hubs, because inmates, when they get released, they got to report to so many different areas, and they're not communicating with each other, the different areas they got to report to. So the inmate starts getting technical violations because the appointments are not in line with each other. They're just conflicting with each other. And next thing you know, you have an inmate that's back. They're trying to do the right thing, but they had to make a choice. It's like, Angie, I was supposed to go to my parole officer, but I was in college finishing up an exam. And then the moment I missed it, I went ahead and they called the facility, and I went ahead and got rearrested. And then you have some, even with the halfway houses. Halfway houses are private, you know, for the most part, and they're run by money, the dollar. And you can have an inmate that, you know, is at school tied up on a test, and they have to make a call to check in, and they can't because they're taking a test. And they go to call, you know, they call like a minute too late. It doesn't matter, because the halfway houses are trained that if the inmate misses a call by even just a second, they have to call it in as an escape or a potential walk-off, whatever it is. So you have a lot of things that are conflicting with each other. And then you get the inmate coming back on a technicality. And then when you're looking at it, you're like, you know what? I mean, really? I mean, whose fault was that really at that point? So again, I'm putting it back on the community. You know, we do what we can behind the wall, but the failure comes in the transition of, you know, what we do now and how that applies. And I see a lot of, as I grow in this profession, I see things a little bit differently, but I see a lot of facilities or a lot of agencies are trying to have more reentry events where they're trying to bring the community and say, hey, listen, we're doing our part. And here's the sad thing, guys. When the inmate makes a mistake and they go back to the facility, or when they make and they commit another crime and they go back to the facility, they blame the prison. You didn't do enough while they were in there. What are you talking about? Have you seen the stuff we did? But the inmate went out and he couldn't find a fucking job. That's on us. That's our fault. That's unfair. You know, that's unfair. And as I said, I mean, that seems to be, that happens a lot. We remember, I remember going to an event one day where the lady spoke the truth. She said, I'm going to tell you something right now. Nobody expected this. She stood up and said, I'm going to tell you something right now. The failure didn't come from the facility. I was locked there for 20 years. It didn't come from them. I was a tough blah, blah, blah. You know, they got to me. I go to the community. No one gave two shits about me. And at that point, my best objective was to commit a crime and go back to what I know. So let's see. We've got a few more questions before we wrap it up. Let's see. Hold on, guys, because there's a lot of questions here. What's the repercussion of an inmate who gets caught with drugs or et cetera? I mean, I have every facility operate differently. I'll go with Joe first and then Russ and then myself. So go ahead, Joe.
Well, I mean, they may operate a little different, but it's basically the same principle. Any inmate that gets caught with drugs or any kind of dangerous contraband faces not only internal disciplinary measures, but they also face the chance of taking another conviction for being in possession of dangerous drugs or any kind of dangerous contraband while in a penal facility, you know, which they could get extra time for. And it's not just drugs, cell phones as well in Texas. Just had a couple of convicts 3 years ago, got their fifth felony for being in possession of a cell phone in a penitentiary and turned a 25-year sentence into a life sentence.
Yeah. What's your thoughts on that, Joe? I mean, Russ.
There's always, of course, the chance that, you know, someone's going to get caught and end up doing extra time. But, you know, there's also the other side of it. If you want to view it from a different facet, if they get caught by us trying to bring in drugs and they weren't paying taxes to an STG for those drugs, they could be targeted for assault or killings or or everything else. Also, you know, if they're bringing in drugs and someone else has paid the bills on those and we manage to take those away, they can be what's called a double up or a triple up, where they have to pay that money that they were fronted for those drugs back, or once again face being, you know, stabbed or killed or everything else. You know, I would say that the worst thing that we see about drugs is drugs allows the STGs to leverage power inside all of the prisons. And that goes for all the prisons across the United States. If it wasn't for those drugs and the fact that it's so lucrative to smuggle them in and to give them the power that they need to be able to reach out and touch someone, you know, across the state or across the country, jails and prisons would be much nicer places.
Yeah. And guys, for us, you know, the inmates going to be put on what they call zero tolerance. So basically, the one thing you take away from them is their visits. Because again, you don't know how they got the drugs in. So the first thing you do is kind of work on the visits. By the way, they can get it in many ways. But one of the ways we do is we stop the visits. Investigations are going to be done. So the inmate can no longer get contact visits while they're investigating the matter. They probably get their stuff screened, like their phones. They get their mail gets put on a checklist. You know what I mean? So people can check their mail within reason. Again, not to read the mail, but just to check for contraband. So basically, the punishment will probably relate to the roads that they could took to get the drugs in, especially the visits. Is sorry, you want to mess that up? I don't know how you got the visits right now. I don't know how you got the drugs in, but here's what we're going to do. No contact visits. And again, it's just a universal precaution because drugs are one of the biggest threats to our facility because of the overdoses. So, you know, it's not something that we take lightly. So again, you know, bravo to the mailroom, but bravo to the people that are stopping that from coming in. This is a good question. Have your facilities and staff through the pandemic new measures and protocols for quarantine and control implement in case new disease, deadly variants come along the way? So COVID was a hit for us in corrections, more so than any other profession, I believe, because of how close we are and how fast at the time COVID could spread. I've had COVID 5 times already. I actually just had it a couple of days ago. I got tested positive. You know, it's the exposure. Now I'm all triple boosted. We were forced to do those because again, you're in a close knit area, so it spreads like wildfire. When this first started, we had inmates that were dying, and we had officers that were dying all across the country, and you know, we had to come up with measures quick. But while we were going through it, so plans were changing and constantly because, you know, we were still trying to figure out what the hell this was. And I remember I was in correction. I remember it from being most severe, where somebody just talked to you. You got to lock every down and anybody you contact with, they're out of work for 10 days. And now it's more of you tested positive. I'll see you in a few days. You know, they don't even ask for the contact list anymore, or because they expect everybody at this point to be boosted up. But with that said, you know, the measures that we have in place are you do testing for the MA population weekly, you know, which again, it's money, but you do it. You try to push the mandate for the mask, which is easier said than done, both sides, staff and inmates. I mean, remember guys, we've worked through this pandemic. We don't get to work from home. You know, we have to be there. So yeah, not like, you know, I know everybody's these heroes. We're working every day. So we've gone through it. Like someone from the outside that hasn't been to work, it's funny because the court system shut down for a while and they're still trying to operate as if they can work from home, as if we're in this still pre-pandemic or whatever it is, or I'm sorry, pandemic. So having said that, they'll come in, they'll try to tell us, hey, you guys not wearing your mask. But it's like, okay, we'll fix it. But just advise. I mean, we've kind of gone through this like for the last couple of years. We're kind of a little disenfranchised over it. So it's just a matter of reminding them and keeping them motivated. Staff also gets tested weekly. If you tested positive, then you don't test again for 90 days. As soon as you test positive, you get sent home. If an inmate tests positive, we have quarantine and isolation. So we have quarantine for inmates that, they could have been exposed to it, but doesn't mean that they have it. So I'll give you an example. If me and Russ shared the same cell, because it used to be bigger, but if me and Russ shared the same cell and Russ was positive, Russ would be isolated. And if I would be quarantined, because again, you don't know if I have it. Or if I was symptomatic and I'm waiting for my test results, I could still be isolated. But having said that, it's more about mitigating the risk to spread it. At one point, we had inmates sleeping foot to head. So we've got inmates that are in dorms because we were afraid of them breathing on each other. If they were partnered cell to cell, you'd have an inmate's head here and an inmate's head here, you know, so they wouldn't be directly breathing on each other. But when it makes it hard, because when it spreads like wildfire, and we run out of room quick in order to quarantine and isolate inmates. And then having said that, you want to use another facility, but if that facility's numbers aren't high, they're not going to want to take your inmate, because like, hey, go, I know we got the room, but we can't take them because our numbers aren't that high. So you wind up having to mitigate it at your facility. But I will tell you right now, it's lessened. It's not as bad as it was, but it was hell, and we were doing our best. And you know, and it was funny because as we were developing our plan, we were trying to discover what works best. Because we wound up having to go back and forth, a lot of the inmates and a lot of staff started to lose trust in the efforts. But you got to understand, we were discovering this. So what we had to do is we had to provide some level of transparency to let them see what the efforts are. Because if you were just going by the outcome, I wouldn't trust us either. But if you could understand why we had to shift all these times and, you know, just what was happening that caused the shift, and that we, it's not that we didn't know it's not like we didn't know how to handle a pandemic, because we did, but not something like this where the news would change its severity every day. And, you know, now it's airborne. It's like, fuck. And then it's like, you know, and it's just the news constantly changing what it was. And then the guidelines, it's like, hey, guys, we got to start doing this now. We got to start doing that now, because they just said that this is a new variant. And now we got to prepare for this. So it just kept us running around a lot. It was hell, but we pulled through. I just got a few more questions, then we can wrap it up, because there's a few. Let me just see. Hold on. Maybe we are good. I think we are caught up. Let's actually get our closing thoughts. I think we're – oh, wait. Have you facility stuff? Oh, no, we did. Okay. So we can start closing off. And, guys, by the way, we're going to start doing more lives. That's kind of what we want to do this year. So we're willing to answer any questions. When I do a live, some of it may be topic-driven, but we will answer any question that comes our way. So if you know people that are you know, or in the profession, you want to kind of bring them over, or people that have somebody in the profession. And I will tell you this, and I'm putting it out there. We will give you the right answers, as opposed to some of those channels that are run by former inmates that, you know, they're big channels, but they're not 100% accurate. They're not. Their job right now is to bastardize the system. At the end of the day, they're going to give out all information that deals with that. And they're really not telling you the truth, because in the end, guys, I've worked in this system and we're not perfect. I know we're not perfect. I get it, but what profession really is? But at the end of the day, guys, we do some really outstanding work that's not put out there because it just doesn't get the attention. But think about this. We have a lot of inmates that are locked up, a lot. And once in a while, yes, there's going to be negative interactions, but think about the ratio. Think about, you know, of how many interactions across the country we're having with inmates daily. That means that, you know, we may get one or two negative stories in the news, which get on fairly generalized as if that's the common practice. But let's not ignore the millions of other interactions that happened in the last minute that were positive. And I'm going to bring more of that on here. I'm going to bring on people that had positive interactions. I'm going to share stories. I got videos on here. We interviewed Ann Salter about pedophiles. We got manipulation videos, how manipulation works. I mean, I have a whole course on inmate manipulation if you want to see how that works. I got a book on the market called, right behind me, Inmate Manipulation Decoded. And also some of the other videos that we do, just so you know. A lot of it's based on human behavior, so we do a lot of stuff with leadership and stuff like that. But having you guys be a part of the channel, I'd be willing to answer whatever questions you ask, just to give you more information about what we do. So I think it gets out more, because that's the key, because I think this profession is the most understood, because we're on the back end of politics, and it's unfair, because corrections can't win either way. If you're on the left side, you know, it's all inmate. If you're on the right side, I want to privatize. And at the end of the day, we just want to do our fucking job. So I will open up avenues with my experts and my guests, and I will answer all the questions as honestly as I can, as fairly as I can. And I think that will provide. And by the way, by the questions you ask, we also learn more. But go ahead, Joe. You got anything you'd like to say in closing?
Yeah. You know, number one, I'm glad we're back to doing lives. I've missed it. It's been a while, and I look forward to doing more, definitely more often. Great to see everybody in there, and I appreciate everybody that's come over. Definitely appreciate Duty Ron for giving us the shout out, and everybody that's come over to watch. Like Anthony said, we'll do everything within our power to give you the right answers. You know, sometimes the truth hurts, but it will be the right answer. Man, it's just the COs that are out there walking this beat every day. You know, during this understaffing and the stuff that they have to endure while they're doing it, man. For those of y'all watching, just know that I'm proud of you. I respect you more than you guys will ever know. And, you know, I've always been an advocate for a CO. I was a CO, and even when I promoted up to lieutenant, one thing I've always said is once a CO, always a CO. So you guys keep doing what you do, and know that you definitely have a force out here backing you guys. And other than that, man, y'all have a great evening. It's been awesome. Can't wait to do more lives. I don't know how many more times I'm going to shave, but I'm definitely not going to try to come in here looking like Doug Dynasty like I did last week. Anthony was just looking at me kind of crazy, man. So
it worked. Hey, Russ, you got anything you'd like to say in closing?
You know, just thank you to everyone out there, you know, that showed up and asked a question. And if there's some of you out there that were too shy, maybe, you know, next time, you know, this is a great profession. I spent, you know, most of my years in this profession, more than half of my life. And so, you know, I like being able to pass on the information. I like being able to think that, you know, we're making corrections a little bit better. There's probably a long ways to go still, but I think that, you know, that between Tier Talk and Keepers of Chaos and some of the other venues out there, that, you know, maybe we really can have an impact, and an impact that'll make it easier for the officers and even better for the inmates, perhaps.
Yeah. And then, guys, first of all, I want to thank you guys. Duty Ron, awesome. You brought me in for a show today, and you know, you go in, you smile, and then you get a lot of people that just believe in the message that you're given, and then they come back to the channel and they validate that belief when they subscribe and hopefully invest in the channel. This is a tough channel, guys, because it's a very secured niche, and it's not one that's favorable by YouTube. It's a channel that they will not let me monetize, and it's funny because there's nothing disrespectful being done on this channel, so having the people come in and ask questions, and we have fun. I mean, I have Connie Eileen that comes on, Alicia knows them, and Joe, and we go off topic once in a while. You know, we talk about things that doesn't only relate to corrections, you know, recent books that we've read. We have authors that come on once in a while, but in the end, I think what's great about what we do here is that we provide insight into a world that most people know very little about, but unfortunately they don't tell people that. They tell people false truths, and then we wind up doing our best to let people know that this is what goes on in this profession. And what kickstarted this channel was, I was always proud of the work I did, especially when I worked at the female facility. And then there was one person at a toll collector out of all the people in the world who basically thought what we did was a joke, and basically all we did all day was rape the female inmates. And having identified with the profession, I took it a certain way, and Tear Talk began. And it began in 2012. You know, a bunch of different outlets. I'm also a writer. I know Russ hates the press, but I am a journalist. I am certified as U.S. press. You know, so I do tend to write pretty well. But with that said, guys, it's all about sending the positive message, and it starts with you guys. So you guys coming here, taking your time to talk shop with us correctional professionals. And next week we'll do another live. I'll set it in advance. If you guys have any topics you want to discuss, let me know. Just email myself, GANGIANTHONY@yahoo.com, or you can email Russ. Russ, what's your email?
Sierra.Sergeant@gmail.com, and that's Sierra.Sergeant@gmail.com.
And then, Joe, what do you got?
Mine's K5JEP3@gmail.com.
Yeah, and guys, if you have any show topics, I mean, we could do stuff that's relevant to the times, but we just have to give us some time to look it up, because I'm still active on the job. Joe still's active. Well, he works for AutoZone. And then Russ is definitely still active. Russ rehabilitates now. So imagine that, guys. A guy 6 foot five, 6 foot six coming to you and demanding your ass changes. You
know, yes, sir.
Yeah, Russ is a different type. You ever, what is it? Like, you know, you got good cop, bad cop. I'm a different kind of cop. Well, Russ is like a different type of rehabilitator. You change or I'll fucking make you change. And, you know, and that's how. But, yeah, we can talk about anything. Juveniles, death row. I'll just give me a chance and I'll bring an expert who's worked that area. And we could just shoot the shit all day. And yes, I am going to start doing more lives one a week. I'll try to maybe either do them Thursday or Friday and I'll keep it consistent throughout the whole year. And we'll just have some fun and talk shop. So get those questions asked and we'll get those questions answered. As always, guys, love you guys. Thanks for seeing you guys. My subscriber count went up a few hundred already. I'm excited. I'm hoping to get that 100,000 one day so I can get that silver button that Ron has. But here's the question, though. If I do get that amount of followers and YouTube doesn't monetize me, will they spend the money on me and give me the silver play button?
No.
I don't think they will. So... All right, guys. Love you guys. Stay safe.